Remembrance of Things Past by Marcel Proust. The Guermantes Way, Part 1. The twittering of the birds at daybreak sounded insipid to Françoise. Every word uttered by the maids upstairs made her jump. Disturbed by all their running about, she kept asking herself what they could be doing. In other words, we had moved. Certainly the servants had made no less noise in the attics of our old home, but she knew them. She had made of their comings and goings familiar events. Now she faced even silence with a strained attention. And as our new neighbourhood appeared to be as quiet as the boulevard onto which we had hitherto looked had been noisy, the song, distinct at a distance, when it was still quite faint like an orchestral motif, of a passer-by, brought tears to the eyes of a Françoise in exile. And so, if I had been tempted to laugh at her in her misery, at having to leave a house in which she was so well respected on all sides, and had packed her trunks with tears, according to the use of Cambrai, declaring superior to all possible houses that which had been ours. On the other hand, I, who found it as hard to assimilate new as I found it easy to abandon old conditions, I felt myself drawn towards our old servant when I saw that this installation of herself in a building where she had not yet received from the hall porter, who did not yet know us, the marks of respect necessary to her moral well-being, had brought her positively to the verge of dissolution. She alone could understand what I was feeling. And so I went straight to Françoise, who, in return for my having laughed at her tears over a removal which had left me cold, now showed an icy indifference to my sorrow, but because she shared it. Françoise, who would not allow the least of her own ailments to pass unnoticed, if I were in pain, would turn her head from me, so that I should not have the satisfaction of seeing my sufferings pitied, or so much as observed. It was the same as soon as I tried to speak to her about our new house. Moreover, having been obliged a day or two later to return to the house we had just left, to retrieve some clothes which had been overlooked in our removal, while I, as a result of it, had still a temperature, and like a boa constrictor that has just swallowed an ox, felt myself painfully distended by the sight of a long wardrobe trunk which my eyes had still to digest, Françoise, with the inconstancy of women, came back saying that she had really thought she would stifle in our old boulevard, it was so stuffy, and that she found it quite a day's journey to get there, and that never had she seen such stairs, that she would not go back to live there for a king's ransom, not if you were to offer her millions, a pure hypothesis, and that everything that is to say to do with the kitchen and the usual offices, was much better fitted up in the new house. Which it is high time now that the reader should be told, and told also that we have moved into it because my grandmother, not having been at all well, though we took care to keep this reason from her, was in need of better air, was a flat forming part of the Hôtel de Guermantes. It is not only to towns and rivers that names give an individuality, as do allegorical paintings. It is not only the physical universe which they pattern with differences, people with marvels. There is the social universe also. And so every historic house in town or country has its lady or its fairy, as every forest has its spirit, as there is a nymph for every stream. Sometimes, hidden in the heart of its name, the fairy is transformed to suit the life of our imagination by which she lives. Thus it was that the atmosphere in which Madame de Guermantes existed in me, after having been for years no more than a shadow cast by a magic lantern slide, or the light falling through a painted window, began to let its colours fade when quite other dreams impregnated it with the bubbling coolness of swift-flowing streams. The name Guermantes, resuming for a moment after all these years the sound so different from its sound today, which it had for me on the day of Mademoiselle Persepied's marriage, brings back to me that mauve, so delicate, almost too bright, too new, with which the billowy scarf of the young Duchess glowed, and like two periwinkle flowers growing beyond reach and blossoming now again, her two eyes sunlit with an azure smile. And the name Guermantes of those days is also like one of those little balloons which have been filled with oxygen or some such gas. When I come to explode it, to make it emit what it contains, I breathe the air of Cambrai.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.